And the
podcast
begins with a song of rebellion.
How can this
podcast
be my life?
CD Burners.
Okay. Welcome back, guys, to PP Burners. The show about sexually transmitted infections that burn your pee pee.
Did you have that banked?
No, it just came.
You didn't have that banked?
Just like literally.
To make
right
me
now.
Laugh? You didn't do that? Our God is a good God. Mm-hmm. That's good. Welcome to CD Burners. It's Morgan and TJ. Today we're going to be spreading some misinformation, I'm sure.
Today we're definitely going to show our ass and. I think the fans of this album are the ones who will come for us.
I honestly hope they do. Here's the thing. I hope you guys do come for us because I like learning. There's nothing that you can say to me that's going to hurt my feelings. You can say anything you want to me. Nothing. I've heard it all. You're not going to hurt my feelings for being like, hey, you fucking idiot. You got this thing wrong. You know? Like, it's not... Well, so we're talking about... talking about a huge album.
We have it in the stew today. This is the first time we have the physical record. This is My Chemical Romance, The Black Parade.
Yeah, I knew more about this than I thought I did, which, you know, because when you think about emo, like anybody you talk to.
I mean, Andy Cohen asked me right away. This is the first band that I said.
And like when, you know, because we've worked with so many people in and around entertainment and they're like, what do you do? And I'm like, we do something called emo night. And they're like, oh, like My Chemical Romance. You know, like that, like for, you know, for some reason, that's the band.
Well, they kind of, I wouldn't say they defined the genre, but I would say that this album is probably the peak of emo and its popularity and like funding like old school music industry funding for shit. This was like a album that came out on Reprise Records, which is actually Warner Brothers Records, and they threw so much money at everything surrounding this album, the merch, the music, the tour, all of it. It is extremely well done. Extremely well produced. And I would say that this is kind of like the thing that defined and left the most lasting impression on people about emo and the genre and its popularity.
Now, whether that is like correct, like, you know what I mean? Like whether that's like right or wrong, it just is. Like that is the thing. That's why, like, you know, 70-year-old white dudes when I go in these meetings are like, oh, like My Chemical Romance. You know, they don't know shit about anything that we do, but they know that, you know, sure. If that's associated with emo. Now, whether or not it is or isn't, fight in the comments, you know what I mean? But that's, you can't argue with the fucking fact that there are people that, like, don't know what emo is at all, and they will go, oh, like, oh, My Chemical Romance.
So this is actually the band's third album. It is produced by Rob Cavallo. He also worked on Dookie, American Idiot, Brand New Eyes, basically every Goo Goo Dolls album. He's worked with Avril Lavigne and the first Maroon 5 album.
Dude, you know what's weird is when people tell me, and I don't think this at all. I don't think this at all. But when people are like, you look like somebody, I get Adam Levine a lot.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I don't think so at all.
It's because of the tattoos.
Yeah, but everybody has fucking tattoos.
I can see it.
I don't see it at all. That's the one I don't see. I see Bert. I see the guy from The Walking Dead. But that's really it. Yeah. You know, and I see Kurt, you know, sometimes when I had my hair. But like, I don't see that guy. Anyway, goddamn, dude, I wish we were doing Dookie also. Shit.
Well, this album debuted at number 2 on the Billboard 200, right behind Hannah Montana.
What a fucking funny thing to debut behind, dude.
I know, it's like, oh, we could have had that number 1 spot, but Hannah Montana took it.
What a fucking hilarious juxtaposition of, like, what is at the top, right? Yeah, like, yeah. We're fucking so wild.
It has been certified 4 times platinum by the RIAA. It was nominated in 2008 for the best boxed/limited edition package. See, this is what I'm talking about. Label pumping money.
Oh, I mean, dude, I have some examples of label pumping money into this fucking album too, but I want to let you go through your thing.
That's about it, really. They sold 240,000 copies in the first week. This is a big jump from their last record, Three Cheers, which sold 38,000 in the first week.
And, you know, I feel like I hear every once in a while and give some opinions. That's my favorite My Chem record, right? Three Cheers?
Three Cheers? Yeah. I think it's their best one.
Yeah.
I think that they should be playing it at When We Were Young. I don't think they should be playing the Black Parade, to be honest with you.
Here's the thing. I did agree with you, and then I went back and listened to this, and now I disagree with you.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I think that this one is fucking awesome. I think that this is an awesome, awesome, awesome
really?
Album. Yeah, I really like it a lot. There's a couple things about it that I dislike, but there's a couple things about it that I think are monumental and I think are incredibly important. Like you said, that this was like a, you know, heavily funded album. You know, where they were recording it or where they were staying while they were writing it was in this fucking, what's that
place? Haunted house.
It was called the Paramore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if you look at like what the Paramore looks like or what it's worth or what it's sold for, it's in the high millions.
So the Paramore is a house in Los Angeles, right?
It's a house in Los Angeles. It's in the hills in Los Angeles. And so they wrote the majority of this album there. They also wrote it, you know, it's really also really cool because they like wrote some of these songs like in a van at Warped Tour.
Why did they pick that place? Do you know?
I do know. Do you know or are you quizzing
I don't.
Me? Okay. I didn't know if you were like,
this is a podcast. I'm trying to make some conversation.
So I do believe that it was because Papa Roach also did some stuff there too. Rick Rubin or somebody, it was something like that. Like Rick Rubin was like, you got to go to this like spooky house there. And they were like, oh, that sounds appealing. I don't know if it was, like I said, this is the podcast of musical misinformation, but it was something like that where somebody like that, they suggested that they go and write at that house, which that house has a little bit of a little, you know, this is, if you guys are watching this, you like my, you know, if you found us from fucking just looking up My Chemical Romance, there's a good chance you like spooky shit. The house has spooky shit that has happened, you know, it's got like a strangely dark history. You know, so the lady that owned it, I think it was like an oil tycoon. And then she drove her car off of Mulholland Drive and died. And then it got turned into like a nunnery or some other shit. And then there was another thing that happened there. Or someone was murdered there. Somebody was murdered there. And then they don't know where. They would said that she's buried on the ground somewhere, but they don't actually know. And then, so what they think is that they spread her ashes all over the place, and that's why she fucking, you know, there have been these strange occurrences. But, you know, there hasn't been a ghost sighting there, per se. What kind of theorists or like people have said about it is that she like hates like rock music. And you know, and so, you know, Papa Roach had Jacoby had sort of this a similar experience while he was staying there. I mean, the guys were having some mental health issues. Mikey Way was having some mental health stuff. Gerard was doing the, you know, the drugs and alcohol stuff at the time. And you know, it was like a really turbulent time for the band in general, personally, while they were recording or writing at that house. So there's a lot of things. Like, I think that, like, Mikey was, like, stayed in the room that had, like, the most fucked up vibes. Like, it was the one that was, like, the most fucked up. And I said something like there's, like, a little blue light that was, like, swung and it didn't, like, illuminate everything. And, like, you know, if you guys want to know what this place looks or like what it's like, if it looks familiar, it's been REM's music video, Halloween H2O, Scream 3, Monk, Britney Spears music video, My Prerogative, Let's Go. Brother, never heard of that. And Noel Gallagher's High Flying Birds music videos, like for If I Had a Gun. So there've been a lot of shit that's happened there. I think that they've like, you know, it was turned into like the place where I live in Los Angeles. There's a lot of places that were turned into like nunneries, and the vibes, you know, it is just that. Like, I haven't seen anything or, you know, heard anything in my place, but like you can feel it. And like, I think with what the band was going for this album, they're like, we want to stay in a place that like really makes us feel it. I think that they maybe felt it a little bit too hard. Like, Jacoby said that there was like, or it was either Jacoby.
This is crazy. What? I didn't know that this is the fucking place that Katy Perry was trying to buy.
Yeah.
And she got in like a big fight.
Yeah, she got a lot
with the nuns.
Yeah. She got in a big fucking dispute over this place. So I forgot if it's like I forgot if it's MyCam or Papa Roach, but either way, like doors were closing, like the bathtubs were filling up when there was no people there. So stuff like that, you know, like nothing too insane, but enough that if you're on the fucking verge of being like, I'm having a mental thing, I'm trying to get off drugs and alcohol. Like every time I've tried to get off drugs and alcohol, like one time I tried to went to fucking Bisbee, which is the creepiest place in the entire world to go. And I was like, this is fucked. Like, I was like, this is so fucked. You can, like, really feel the energy of where your surroundings are, especially when all your, like, senses are heightened. So, like, you know, but also at the same time, maybe thank God, because then we wouldn't have gotten the album that we did get.
Yeah. Well, just like the last episode of this podcast, we talked about Say Anything is a Real Boy, how it was a rock opera. This is a rock opera. However, it is quite a bit more structured than Max Bemis's rock opera. This has very clear characters. It has a story. Do you want to tell us a little bit
about
the
story? No, I want
you
to tell about the story, because I'm going to go all over the place because I have a lot to say, and you are better at going like, this is what it is.
Well, this is focused about, the album is focused around the patient who has cancer. Gerard Way believed that when you die, you're met with one of your happiest and earliest memories, which is, for the patient, the Black Parade, his father bringing him into the city. The album tells the story of this patient and how he learns about his cancer diagnosis, his impending death, his regrets, and the afterlife. A lot of the themes on the album are death in both a romantic and non-romantic sense, the afterlife and reflecting on your life, feeling grief and remorse. There was actually a whole Reddit thread that Joni found for us where somebody breaks down everything track by track and kind of, you know, what each track means. I'm not going to go into that on this podcast, but
let's not. But I mean, like you said, like this is a rock opera, and it was like very much inspired by David Bowie and by The Wall. And like, I think you can really hear it. The thing about the track ordering and the track listing, like what you were just talking about, I've seen a lot of other reviews that are like, this is not a this track by this track by this track by this track. It's fucking mixed up. And they go like, this is why it should go here. This is why this should go here. And this is why this should go here. I'm going to reel it back a little bit because I feel like we jumped in really hot, because it is like a really, really, really interesting album to talk about, and it's a really interesting band to talk about, and it's a really interesting concept. And the concept is the thing that really like got me, because at the time you have all of these emo bands that are writing songs about what we generally view emo to be about.
Girls, heartbreak. Yes.
And this was like, I'm going to take something that's not even me. I'm going to write a story around it that doesn't have to do with strictly love. What I got out of this album was that it is based on fear, acceptance, all of the things that I fucking do on a daily basis with like AA crap, you know what I mean? Like where it's like, it also did, you know, I'm going to, dude, this, I'm so stupid. I'm the stupidest person alive. But like, you know, there are stories that have been written like this that I don't even know if they were influenced by, you know, like I looked up three or four, like I was like, hey, like what, like let me find some similar things, right?
Okay.
And like I gotta tell you, like Dante's Inferno, the reason why you'd be like, all right, you know, it's a Divine Comedy and describes Dante's journey through the nine circles of the gates of hell, but you know, like the Black Parade, it like explores the themes of death, afterlife, and moral reflection. Moral reflection is like what this album really, really, really stands out to me. And same thing like fucking Christmas Carol too, dude. You know, you have a person that lives up to their whole fucking life and then they go, oh, god damn, I was a dick to that person or I was shitty. Like, I should have done things differently. And to have a band like My Chemical Romance come and, whether they knew it or not, you know, subliminally like playing to people being like, hey, you know, you, one day you're going to die, and are you doing the things in your life that you are proud of?
It is a tale as old as time.
You know?
For sure.
And I think that that is an incredible thing and a feat in itself to do as an album. Like, especially by an album by a band that looks and sounds like My Chemical Romance.
Well, speaking of their look, they completely changed up their look for this album. They actually performed not as My Chemical Romance, but as a different band called The Black Parade. This is similar to how David Bowie would perform as Ziggy Stardust, or the Beatles would perform as Sgt. Pepper's. Mexico 2008 was the last show of their tour. They did like 147 shows. I don't know the exact number. I lost the number in my notes, but they did a shit ton of shows as the Black Parade. And on this last show in Mexico, they recorded it as their live album and they killed the band. And Gerard viewed this actually as the end of the band itself.
So, another thing about them, these motherfuckers love a theme.
Yeah.
And boy, do we love a theme, right? So, like, when I was looking back at the, when I was like going back, I was like, dude, you know, the first, you know, or Three Cheers was like about like revenge and angst. And this one is more about like redemption. And to be able to do that musically is a strong, it's a, you know, A, it's admirable. I think that this, I think The Black Parade was written before like the concept of it, or that song was like, parts of it were written before this whole idea came into place. And they've been sitting on it for like, I think since before or during Three Cheers. They're like, you know, have this idea, kick it around. And actually, it's how a lot of the songs on this album, you know, came to them. Like, and the way that they wrote these songs were really interesting as well. We can go into that. But I mean, I think the podcast of misinformation, CD Burners, I read somewhere that it was originally going to be called Father.
Interesting.
Roast me, guys. I don't fucking know, man. But it's like, it's the misinformation musical show. You know what I mean? It's set up like it does the thing that like every good story has, right? It's got the arc. It does the arc. It's like the beginning, the middle, and the end. It's the hero's journey sort of deal. And that's what it was really interesting to listen to this album and being like, is it consecutive or is it not? Which I kind of am tending to go with it's not.
Yeah, it kind of jumps around timeline-wise, I think, for sure.
It's also sang by, like, you know, this is another theory, that it's like all of the songs that start with like softer or like piano or like acoustic are sang by the patient.
Mm.
And all of the songs that start really, really heavy are sang by death. So there's a lot of interpretations to this album. You know, that's the one that I think kind of resonated more with me when I was going back through it. But really what fascinated me the most was the fact that a bunch of fucking young kids can write an album so in depth and so inspired by things that were before their time and make it an album that is our generation's The Wall. It is our generation's That Thing. You know, like, I remember growing up and being like, oh, parents fucked so dumb. Who gives a shit, right? About, you know, like, wants to know about, like, wants to listen to a concept album, you know what I mean? Like, I don't get the whole thing where I'd take acid and go watch fucking Bunch of Lights, you know? And here it's like, they, you know, they're gonna be like, why did you guys wear, like, fucking the way that you wore, dye your hair fucking black and watched a band that's dressed up as a marching band, like, do this thing, you know? It's like, it is our generation's That Thing. There's no deny. There's no other album that does this thing.
Well, you mentioned two things. The marching band uniforms. They were designed by Tim Burton. Iconic.
Loves a spooky. That motherfucker loves spooky shit.
I mean,
shit.
That's the you know, perfect spooky pairing. My Chemical Romance and Tim Burton. And then I also have in the notes here, Gerard Way bleached his hair blonde purposefully and tried to look purposefully sick to channel the character of the patient.
Yeah.
Which I keep thinking about. It's funny to me because I'm like, oh, he dyed his hair blonde. He couldn't commit to the bit of fully shaving his head.
That's probably right. No, well, okay, all right. Look. Like, I bet that it's like a symbolism thing,
no,
right? Like,
100%.
I'm sure that, like, yeah, he probably fucking negotiated it in his head, and he's like, no, it's symbolism.
He just was like, this is going to look way cooler than if, like, I'm fucking bald.
Yeah, he's like, we can call that what it is. But, like, the thing about it is, like, these guys were going through stuff, and they wrote an album that we don't normally see in this type of fucking environment. And for that, I absolutely, like I said, I went back and looking at it from a different perspective and listening to it in full over a little bit more time passing, I'm like, this is the best. This is my favorite one. It also gets you to do something that a lot of us don't do all of the time. Use our goddamn imagination. Like, it really does, you, like, see the things that they're talking about. You're like, who's saying this? Who's saying that? Who's singing this? What the fuck is this about? What does that mean? You know, putting a cryptic thing, you know, like, putting cryptic things here, like, sounds even, which is what I love this shit, when bands are like, we put this, like, sound or this organ that had, like, it was fucking, I don't know, like, found in a old treasure chest, some bulls, you know, fucking whatever the fuck. And we use that on this sound because of this. They did a lot of that.
Yeah, they fully committed to making the concept album. And I can't think of a concept album that has hit like this.
No, when we do the, like, if you like this, you like that, I pulled two concept albums that, like, I like.
Mm-hmm.
I don't love, but I'm like, if you like this, you might like this. If you like the idea of this, you might like this. Musically, they do not sound the same. It doesn't matter. But, like, I found a funny fact. Well, I was talking to my friend about, like, you know, she's like, what albums are you doing this week? And I was like, oh, I'm doing the Black Parade. And she was like, did you know that the lead actor in the Black Parade music video was part of Leonardo DiCaprio's Pussy Posse?
What does that mean?
You didn't know about Leonardo
DiCaprio?
I don't know
the Pussy Posse.
You don't know the Pussy Posse?
No.
Okay, so in, like, the 2000s, there was, like, a group of dudes in Hollywood. They were all hot. Every single one of them was, like, hot, and then there was, like, an oddball out. It was, like, Brad Pitt, Leonardo DiCaprio, like, George Clooney, I think, you know, my memory. Mm. You smoke shit off tinfoil for 10 years, your brain turns into mush. So I and the podcast of misinformation. Either way. There was another dude in the Pussy Posse, and the lead actor in the music video was part of the Pussy Posse.
Which, like, the guy, the patient?
Yeah.
Huh.
I mean, I that's just, you know, somebody, like, she could have just been like, hey, I'm going to tell Morgan a lie because he'll believe this, and then he'll say it on a podcast.
I mean, that's like just a Hollywood lore that you hear. Oh.
I mean, we could look up the actor right now and figure it out.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could do that.
I'm watching this music video right now to take a glimpse at who you're talking
about. Okay, and then you're
and
gonna
it
look
is
it up.
quite the fucking video, dude.
This
video, I wonder how much this cost. One person that I do want to talk to about this record, so we'll have him on maybe at the end of this, our friend Steve Morales, he actually ran marketing at Warner Brothers during this time. So he helped launch like the MCRmy and was very, very instrumental in the rollout of this album. So it'll be really interesting to hear his insights on all of this. But this video had to cost like millions.
Dude, it also like when recording this is another cool fucking fact that I actually pulled, and that is real. So you guys can so like I'm not just saying shit. The Black Parade at the time recording it was they held the record for like the most amount of tracks on a
Pro
recording
Tools or whatever.
Yeah, and it was 167.
Wow.
It's a fucking massive, massive, massive file.
So layered.
Yeah. So at the time, I'm sure there have been fucking, you know, maybe not. I don't know. Maybe they still hold the world record, but like, you know, it's.
Well, it seems like we're jumping into fast facts here. So one fast fact that I found was that Frank Iero and Gerard Way's parents sing at the end of Mama.
You know who else does?
Liza Minnelli. Isn't that wild?
Yes, dude. It's fucking
crazy. They got
crazy.
Liza Minnelli?
No, it's fucking
That's
crazy.
So sick.
It's so sick. Like, I want to know, like, how that happened.
Yeah.
Like, that would be a cool thing to, like, actually, when we talk to the people that we're going to talk to, be like, how the fuck, if we could figure out some of that stuff and ask those specific questions, because that's a cool thing. I don't know if you got, look, you know, if you're a fan of My Chemical Romance, like, you know, or just like a average My Chemical Romance fan, you might not know that Liza Minnelli took part in this album, which is fucking awesome. What a cool thing to do.
Another fast fact, Dead, Famous Last Words, and Teenagers were all featured on Guitar Hero 2.
You're getting, shout out Joni for the fast facts, but the code name for, the code name for the Black Parade was, fuck, all right, ready?
Yeah.
The code name for, fuck, I think it was the Black Parade, but it was The Five of Us Are Dying, which was the code name for that song.
Wow.
Or one of those songs. I don't know, it might have been the album. But either way, they were using that code name back and forth with each other. And right as soon as they were done recording that album, they had to go to Europe. And Frank Iero is like really superstitious, and he almost didn't get on the plane to go.
Oh.
Yeah, it was like, oh, fuck, we've been saying that shit, you know what I mean? So it's like, you know, they also like, yeah, he did some other cool shit. Like when they were at the Paramore fucking mansion place, you know, with the dark time in that band, like for, what was it, on, you know, what song was it on? House of Wolves. So... They picked up Rob's, like, you know, like, I got like guitars, the engineer, the producer, like, got all these like fucking clunky ass old guitar, you know, these producers have fucking every piece of like wacky equipment you could ever see in your entire life. We went over to the next room over there, you'd see fucking keyboards that were, you know, fuck knows, they might play one note, knows, but they got them. Producers are like incredible collectors, but you know, a lot of these songs were written by like just picking up a thing, like a shitty thing. And, you know, for House of Wolves, they were like, I want to write something my dad would like. And then wrote like a Creedence riff, you know? That's why I'm like, dude, is this, you know, at the same time, like, is this emo? It's not, like, I don't know. There's like these circusy sounding songs, these like very theatrical sounding songs, you know, on this album. And I'm like, what does emo mean anymore? After doing all of these fucking episodes that we've been doing, I'm like, I don't even know if it's a fucking genre.
Yeah, they all sound so different.
Like I don't know I mean, is it, this is the way to look, is it the right way on the time, the era? Like, I have no fucking idea. The dudes were referencing things like, they're referencing things like Looney Tunes. You know, they're referencing things like this Looney Tunes fucking cartoon where, specifically for the very, I fucking forgot what the circusy sounding song is called. But they were like, there's a, where this Looney Tunes character, like, goes to hell and starts, playing, and which is dark for Looney Tunes, but, like, I don't know if they knew that they were pulling things from, like, what I said before, like, Dante's Inferno. I don't know if they knew that. And it also goes to show to, like, pull inspiration from a Looney Tunes scene where they're, like, going to hell. It goes to show, like, how invested in imagination that these guys are, which, you know, if you follow Gerard's career a lot, like, dude loves comic books, he loves comics, he loves, like, stories. And, like, this is, you know, what was the one that we did with them? Umbrella Academy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's, like, a writer on that. And, like,
I mean, that's his creation.
It's his creation. Like, he invented it, you know what I mean? And so, like, this dude's had fucking stories in his head for so long, and, like, to put one of those stories to a musical format and have it be as successful as this, again, another wild thing. Like, just a really, really wild thing to do.
Well, I'm going to clarify some of the misinformation that has been spouted.
This is the podcast of misinformation.
Alternative Press actually did a pretty deep dive here into some of these things that we've been questioning. So the song Mama, it started out as a joke, just with the band, like all good ideas. They were betting Ray Toro. They said, you can't write a polka. And he wrote a polka. And then they kept joking, and they were like, wouldn't it be funny if we got Liza Minnelli on this? And then their team made it happen via satellite. She did it remotely.
So sick.
Yeah.
Dude, before Zoom, they had to call it, like, via satellite? Yeah. What the fuck does that mean?
I don't know, man. What else did we talk about? Oh, House of Wolves. You are not correct about it being inspired by a song that his father would like. House of Wolves is the one that is inspired by a Looney Tunes short, Three Little Bops, where the wolf tries to play trumpet in various jazz clubs and then keeps getting thrown out, and then he blows himself up and winds up in hell. So you were correct about that.
I was right about that.
You just mixed up the song.
Of course I mixed up the songs, dude. When I'm, like, listening to the album, I'll be like, oh, fuck, remember this part. It's like setting a cue point on your fucking CDJ and then going back. But then I go back and I'm like, oh, what was I trying to fucking remember here? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? How do I look this part up? Like, I really fucking listened to the music on this album and the lyrics. I know the first couple, I didn't know as well. Like, admittedly, I didn't know, like, the Sleeping with Sirens album that well, you know, and, like, talked to Kellen about that. But, like, this I knew a little bit more, and I also knew a little bit more about the story, and I also knew a little bit about the lore, and I also, like, so I had the ability to listen to it with fresh ears, but also going into it, listening to it, having listened to it, and, you know, a lot in the past. So, I mean, it was, like, Mama was the first song. They gave off that, like, circus cabaret, like, musical theater vibe, you know? It was fucking, like, so, I love that. I love it. Dude, it's like, it kind of, like, I guess, like, with us, I mean, like, I guess, you know, kind of shows, like, our fucking nerdness and dorkness to be, like, we're committing to a theme, you know, and, like, or just, like, passion for what you do, to, like, completely commit to the whole thing, you know. This, my own world, I'm, like, now talking about it out loud is, like, I understand why, I guess, everybody's like, oh, this is the band. You know, there's also, like, their favorite song on this album is not only their favorite song on this album, their favorite song ever.
Is what?
Cancer. And, like, it was really, they wanted it to be, like, very, like.
Do you like that song?
No, I don't. I don't like that song.
I don't really like that song either.
That's the thing. And so it's really strange to me to be like, to you know, that's, like, one I do skip, and then when I you know, like read or heard them talk about like how it is their favorite song and it's so hard to play.
Mm.
You know, I like went back and listened to it in their perspective and I was like, oh.
Well, it is, in a way, it is kind of like the crux of the album. Like it does, it, you know, flat out like lays out the story. Speaking of tracks that we like or dislike, what are your standouts on this album?
Buddy.
Don't act like you're not prepared for this question, because it's we ask it every episode.
I know, but I have a lot. So I think Dead is a like I think it's like a very, very, very strong like right after intro, like right into it. Like I think Dead is, and then obviously, dude, I can't say enough good things about The Black Parade.
It's such a good song.
Like it is. Such a fucking
it's
good
a timeless song.
Song
it's like an anthem for the ages.
It's like the Bohemian Rhapsody of like for like what we have, you yeah. know, like
it was weird to me to listen to this version. I actually didn't realize that the version that we have in our set that we do at festivals is edited and doesn't have that second verse.
The one that we do,
yeah,
I did.
I mean, I knew that, but I'm so used to
hearing that. I always fuck up, though, because, like, when we're, like, singing it live on festivals, I always go into that. Mm-hmm. Like, I think we're going to go into that second
just
verse.
Go straight to the build.
Yeah, I mean, like, I Don't Love You, I like a lot. It's not my favorite tempo for a song.
I really like that song. That song kept hitting for me when I was listening through this album. I would get to I Don't Love You, and it was like... I think that was my standout on this album. That and Famous Last Words. My three are Black Parade, I Don't Love You, and Famous Last Words. I played Famous Last Words at the last emo night, like 2 months ago maybe, and it went off. It was great.
Yeah, dude, I think, I mean, look, the thing is like what you guys are going to come to realize when we do all of these things is like, you know, we all like different stuff. We all like gravitate towards different things, but it's all in the same scene. So when people are like, play this song, it means something different to you than it means something to me. And I might be like, fuck, I hate this song. You might love it. You know what I mean?
Look
so
at
it's,
this. This is.
Dude, they give a so fuck about fun. This stuff. That's the thing. That's why I think that this band is incredibly successful, is because like their attention to detail, the things that they give a fuck about.
There's the boys.
Dude, look at how fucking sick that is.
Yeah.
What a great AI picture.
Really cool. Before dude, AI. That's real. That's...
I know. But like the fucking, like they...
Oh, look, it's that guy. Social repose.
Looks... Oh, that guy's in there?
No, it's definitely not him, but... It's
the guy wears like Indian headdresses?
Looks exactly like his outfit.
I feel like that guy's probably pretty nice.
No, he's bad.
Is he bad?
Canceled.
Did he?
Yeah.
I just figured if you like do that and put that shit on every day, you gotta be like, oh, God,
he's not good.
Nice. Well, either way, it's like, thing is, it's... I was really, you know, I think in totality, like, I am really impressed with them musically and story-wise and like, to tackle themes of life and death and acceptance and fear into an album that sounds like this when every other fucking album was like, I love you, I miss you, I'm like quintessential emo stuff, like... To take a risk to do an album like The Black Parade, to me, you know, that says something. It's what sets these guys apart from everybody else, you know. And I really like, I understand the fandom, because you can live in this world. Like, this is a world you can live in. They give you, My Chemical Romance gives you worlds to live in. You know, you can learn something from this album. Like, you know what I mean? I listened to this album and I was like, shit, dude, if I fucking walk in the dog and I get hit by a car, was I like a dick to somebody? Like, you know, if I'm laying there dead on the street, like, should I apologize to somebody? How are my actions affecting everybody else? And for an album that is done in this era to get me to think like that.
Mm.
In this age, at the age that I am, you know,
at
what
your
I mean?
Big age,
at my big ass age, is like fuck, dude, like you guys did something. And so I think this is a really, really easy, like A plus of an album. You know, there are things on it that I like dislike, but that's a personal opinion, but I can respect it, right? Like there's things that I dislike, but I respect why they did it, the choices that they made, and you know, ultimately the end result to me is like you have to look at it in a whole. And as reviewing albums and like looking at albums as a whole, it's a fucking awesome album. Like I mean everything around it. You know, some of it just hits like these are 10 out of 10 lyrics, these are 10 out of 10 music, this is 10. Like it does the whole thing. It runs the gamut of being like, this is a fucking awesome album.
Well, as big as this album booklet is, it's mostly lyrics. I was jumping into the liner notes here. This is mostly lyrics. I love the use of fonts. This is cool. Like, they have so many different fonts. It looks like an old newspaper.
Yeah, it looks like a fucking old-ass newspaper.
And then very, very tiny, they have their liner notes here. There's a couple of notable names here. One interesting one, I got mixed up. So this album was mixed by Chris Lord Alge. And
that's the guy.
That's what I thought too. And then I Googled it and it's not the guy. It's his brother. There's actually three Lord Alge brothers that are all audio engineers, dude, and mixers.
God damn it, dude. I bet they're fucking so annoying.
So there's Tom Lord Alge, who did Motion City soundtrack. Chris Lord Alge did Black Parade. And then there's another brother. And he didn't really have any like notable credits from the scene, but he had a lot of good credits. So they're all pretty talented guys.
God, I mean, dude, imagine like having kids and like all three of your kids are like geniuses.
Yeah.
Like and having like shit named after them. Like, I don't know, man. The UK really fucked with this album too. Mm. Like the UK really fucked with this album. Like I think it podcast of misinformation. I think it got released in the UK before. But I don't know, whatever. I read a good review of this album. I read a lot. I did, you know, for as much as it feels like I don't do my homework on these, I do. I just forget a lot of shit and I have a lot of thoughts, so it's impossible for me to be like, here's every thought about everything. But I was like, I'm really trying to pay attention, like what I grab and what actually will be helpful and like in the podcast. And good line, good review about the album. I love that. It is a piece of work that will challenge every preconception you ever had about people who made it. Hmm. It was a Rolling Stone. It was a Rolling Stone article. And, you know, like at the time, it seems like Rolling Stone was giving out fucking good reviews to bands we like.
Yeah. Well, Pitchfork wasn't. None of the other fucking music publications were.
I might have talked shit on Rolling Stone in the last episode. Maybe I take that back. And I'm going to take that back and I'm going to switch it to Pitchfork. And I'm going to say, you guys are bullshit.
One weird note that I had here, I don't love you, I wrote, kind of feels like a Coldplay chord progression.
Yeah. Dude, a lot of this was inspired by like things that you would never know, like Creedence. Mm-hmm. Like there's some Creedence shit in there. There's there's a lot of like the dun 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 dun. It's like they looked at like a lot of like Blur and Britpop stuff. Like, I mean, they pulled from everywhere.
Yeah.
They pulled from everywhere for this album. That's not, so I can't for the life of me. Overarching emo, sure. Whatever,
no, it's got like classic rock. It's got so much to it.
But so is, you know, it is like I'll go down. I'm sure somebody's made this comparison before, but like, and to me, it is the Bohemian Rhapsody of our generation.
Yeah, there's absolutely so much Queen on this, like those crazy fucking guitar solos.
Yeah, and usually the way I feel about a guitar solo, I feel like it's selfish. I always feel like a guitar solo is selfish. It's like, look at me, besides Pantera and the way that I've like looked at that, where it sounds like it's, I've always looked at putting a guitar solo in there as a selfish act. But in this album and in this circumstance, it adds to the story and it adds to the like ups and downs and ebbs and flows of the album. So it's appropriate. And it's a like what?
Well, I think that's why maybe you were saying the UK fucked with it so much, because it's so influenced by Queen.
Yeah, and Bowie.
Yeah.
Like, and Bowie, like, those were the two that were, like, you know, out of everything, like, those were the, like, you know, the really big two, you know, because, like, he had, you know, fucking star guy.
Ziggy Stardust.
Yeah, star guy, you know what I mean? And so it's, like, fucking, it was, like, taking on a different character. He's taking on a different Absolutely. Character and applying it to an album. Mm-hmm. And, like, that's, you know, that's, like, what they did.
Well, what do you have for if you like
are
this?
Are you serious?
Is you this, like that?
God damn, dude.
You're done.
We fly through these like a motherfucker. This is wild. This is crazy.
What did you write down?
I hope that you guys are enjoying these because I'm really like feel like I'm only getting a little bit out.
I'm just trying to keep it on track.
Okay. There's two albums that I put down that don't sound anything like this, but if you like this style and conceptual album, I put down the Deer Hunters Act 2, The Meaning of All and Things Regarding Misleading, and The Antlers Hospice.
I've never listened to either of those.
I know. It was like I had a strange, I like, you know, because Coheed does a lot of like conceptual shit, mm-hmm. and I was like, I wonder what other bands did this, and I remember a long time ago I went back and listened to this. One of them sounds like nothing. The Antlers album sounds sort of like droney and like almost nothing, but mm-hmm. it's like a, you know, it's a conceptual album. I think it's really cool. The other one is a little bit more like folky, but both conceptual albums. Love what it. About you?
I didn't choose anything. I didn't pick anything.
You didn't?
No.
If you had to, right now on the spot,
I would probably just say go listen to fucking Ziggy Stardust or listen to Sgt. Pepper.
Yeah, I think wasn't American Idiot.
That's a concept album.
Yeah, like I think American Idiot was.
And Rob Cavallo worked on that.
Yeah, he did. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed our discussion about the Black Parade. I feel like, and this is another one I could have done another hour on, but it is what it is. You're welcome for all of the misinformation. Please take it up with me. And if there's something that you guys are like, yo, you need to know this about the album and you didn't say it, leave it in the comments. Fucking, I want to learn. I'm here to learn as like you guys are here to learn and listen and fucking love this shit. So that's my sign off.
All right, guys. We'll see you next week on CD Burners with another discussion of your favorite albums.
What did you say in the intro?
Pee-pee burners.
Very funny. All right, guys.
Goodbye, burning men.
Yep.
Hey, guys. TJ here. I am currently editing this podcast, and we have two really good interviews for you guys. The first one is with my friend Steve Morales. He worked at Warner Brothers Records during the release of The Black Parade. He's actually called the general of the MCRmy because he was kind of in charge of all of the street team initiatives. He gave us some great interviews, stories, anecdotes from the rollout of the Black Parade. Another crazy thing happened right after we recorded this episode. We had an emo night on Friday, and Rob Cavallo, the producer of the Black Parade, was there. So we connected with him that night. We got on a Zoom with him the following week, and he gave us an incredible interview. He told us some never before told stories about the making of the album and about the song Welcome to the Black Parade. Super, super good interview. I'm excited to share it with you guys. Thanks for listening to CD Burners, and here are those interviews.
All right, guys. Well, welcome to CD Burners. We're here with our friend Steve Morales. He worked at Reprise Warner Brothers Records during the release of The Black Parade. Steve, thank you so much, and welcome to CD Burners.
Hey, thanks for having me, guys. Good to see you, too. Oh, sorry. One second. There's someone bugging me. Go back. Just got to move this out of the way real quick. You know, it's just starts a little bit in the way here. Sorry. Okay. Now I can be comfortable and we can get this. Cool.
So all right. Yeah, I see.
A little crick in the neck here. Yeah. Cool.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about your role at the label on this release?
Yeah, definitely. Well, first of all, thanks for having me on. you know, it was a great time to work in the music business at that time. And it was really the jumpstart to my career. So I was fortunate enough to get an internship at Warner Brothers, and then one of the project managers left. So they offered me a job there. So one of the first bands I got to work with was My Chem. And this was right when they got signed, before they put out Three Cheers for Sweet Revenge. So I worked in the grassroots marketing department. So I was managing street teams. And the first one that we transferred over was My Chem and the MCRmy that a good friend of mine had started and was running when they were on Eyeball Records. So my good friend Losi had run that on the East Coast. And so they already had a good base. So we ingested them into our system, which was called the Street Network. And we already had a few bands on there that we were running and, you know, did really well all throughout the Three Cheers cycle. And then, you know, here was the time for the Black Parade. So the Black Parade was an interesting rollout because, you know, how do you follow that up? You know, everybody was talking at that time about Sophomore Slump, and, you know, you had, you know, the Killers that had put out Hot Fuss. You had, you know, Fall Out Boy that, you know, I mean, that wasn't their Sophomore Slump, but people were saying, like, you know, what are they going to follow it up with? You had Panic, you know, that had the huge breakout. So not necessarily everybody had a Sophomore Slump, but, you know, major label debuts, like what's going to go on here? And we had a very interesting, you know, rollout that we had planned. So the plan was we weren't announcing it traditionally, you know, with it being a concept record and the band going through, you know, this transformation. You know, we initially rolled it out as, you know, the Black Parade. So I think we first rolled it out as just, you know, the Black Parade as an entity is signing to Riot Squad. I think it was the very, very first post that we put on Absolute Punk, and everybody's really confused about it. I was driving around LA and Hollywood at that time in the Black Parade van, which was a lot of fun and got a lot of attention. And so we had that fully wrapped, and it wasn't until after we announced that it was My Chem that we threw it on the hood, their new logo. So everybody was just really confused about what this was, but it was a lot of fun. And
do you have pictures from that? Do you have pictures of that van?
I'd have to find. I'll find it somewhere for sure.
I've only seen that meme of the car that's like wrapped.
Yeah, but I want to see Steve driving in it. I want to see Steve in it.
Yeah.
Yeah. My cousin who works in marketing now, and he worked for, you know, John Reese and John Oakes for a little while. He said that one of the highlights of his high school career was me going to pick him up in the Black Parade van when he was going to Bishopmont High School. But yeah, it was fun driving that around. And, you know, we'd go to concerts. I remember, I think it was a K-Rock concert, maybe like Inland Invasion. And we only had one song out at that point. And so we parked the Black Parade van and we had it all decked out with really good audio. So I, like, you know, had the doors open, and we were just playing one song over and over, and people were kind of getting like sick and tired of it. Like, do you have anything else? And I was like, I mean, I do, but I can't play it right now. And
What song was it?
I'm trying to remember. I don't think it was Welcome to the Black Parade. I think it was something else. I can't remember exactly which one it was. But I remember I had three songs, which was very interesting because, you know, back then we had watermarks, and, you know, there was a lot of albums getting leaked at that point. If you remember, there was like the big joke. I feel like some bands played into it, like All Time Low did a really funny thing, you know, when they released Nothing Personal, when, you know, I think they like gave Jason Tate a copy and they were like, hey, you know, not going to give it to you, not going to give you a copy, like Nothing Personal or something. It was really funny, like the way they played off it. But, you know, back then a lot of albums were getting leaked. So they were very protective over this record. Even the watermarks didn't say My Chemical Romance on it. I believe it said Mark Carson, which was really funny. But everybody had their own watermarks. So I think it was the day before Inland Invasion, I actually got my watermark for that record. And it was, I think it was three songs. And I was probably one of the first people to actually get them. And, you know, they kept saying, like, oh, you know, there's a backup at the plant. Like, the watermarks just aren't being made yet. So it was pretty fun to be able to play those songs there. But yeah, driving the van around was pretty cool. And, you know, we had an amazing, amazing fan base. So we utilized that and the street team, but it was tough because we had so many on there. So it was something that we had never handled before. We had, you know, a couple hundred thousand fans that had signed up across the world. And it was, you know, when we had other bands on, on the street teams, you know, we could, you know, order, you know, 50,000, 100,000 stickers and flyers and distribute them for a tour or whatever. But with the volume we were doing, it was, you know, how do you order that many and how do you justify it for the budget? So something interesting where we had to really figure out the right way to do it at the scale, but still, you know, be true to what like the band wanted to convey. And they were amazing to work with because they still gave us, you know, the same type of involvement, engagement that they did, you know, before they put out Three Cheers, which was awesome. Which I really loved about them.
You know, just in general, like, you know, what is, for people that are listening and that may be a little bit younger, like, what is a street team involvement like look like? What are like the responsibilities of that?
Sure. So that's actually how I got started in the music business. I went to a concert, I think it was at like the House of Blues Anaheim, when it was still on the Disney property, and people were outside handing out flyers, and, you know, got a flyer, might have been for the Used or something, and they said, hey, join our street team. And I was like, okay, I already go to concerts anyway, so why not go and promote bands that I like? So I signed up on their website, and then they would have these, you know, they called them missions, and you'd sign up, and if you're going to concerts, they would have a list of concerts, and you basically sign up to promote brands that you like, bands that you like. And then in exchange, you get, you know, points in our system when you upload photos, and then that gives you chances to get, you know, free concert tickets, meet and greet opportunities, and other cool things. So it's something that we had paid reps across the U.S. in all the major cities, and then we had they managed their own street teams that we connected them with through our platform.
Dude, those like OG influencers.
Yeah, completely.
Let's go.
Yeah. And then, yeah, it was cool because we started, you know, some of the street teams started developing, you know, personas, funnily enough, slightly embarrassing. So I was running the MCRmy. So they would call me the general. And that was like something we created when we were doing the hymn rollout. You know, there was an entity around the person, the gatekeeper was the person who was running that team. So, you know, there's some cool stuff we were able to do back then.
Damn, that's really cool. I mean, does, what is like the, how does it compare to what street teams look like now?
So, you know, it was interesting because at that time period, it was, you know, social media was just getting started through MySpace. So, you know, I was thankfully, you know, very tech savvy. And that was one of the reasons why I was able to get started so early. I was, you know, 20 years old, 21 years old when I got started there, but I could navigate really quickly through MySpace. I was customizing all the pages that we were using. And, you know, I was running our street teams, like e-teams as well. And that was the interesting thing to figure out is like, okay, how do you mobilize all these people? But also you have so many other people that can't partake in these, you know, not everybody's going to concerts. So not everybody has a tour date going through their city. How do you mobilize them as well? So we would do a lot of things on message boards and, hey, you know, put this banner, you know, in your signature or, you know, do all those type of things. So it was utilizing those and just getting people, you know, to do that like word of mouth marketing. So it's similar to, what you're seeing nowadays on TikTok with their whole affiliate program is like the true evolution of what we were doing back then. People are now just getting compensated directly, you know, for what they're doing.
I mean, when you said that the band was like very, very easy to work with in regards to, you know, working with you guys, were they incredibly like particular about what people wanted? They wanted people to see, and at the time before the album came out, and like, were they very hands-on in what was visually represented by the street teams?
So yes, I would say not so much like visually represented by the street teams. They were amazing in the fact of like, they always gave us early access to a lot of things. So it was great because, you know, they would always make sure we took care of the street teams when it came to, you know, early access to songs, to meet and greets in person. Like they made sure they always took care of the street teams, which was awesome. Even down to like, you know, ticket buys across the board, you know, if other departments, you know, weren't getting as much, you know, Brian, who was their manager, Always made sure that we were taken care of, and the street teams were always taken care of for tickets, meet and greets, and that was great. But you know, he at one time was designing all the flyers for what we were handing out. So cool. So yes, very particular in those regards. But then everything else kind of flowed under the overall direction. We worked really close with all my friends that were in the merch department as well. So really, the aesthetic was always very defined, very, you know, true to Gerard's vision, and I think that they saw the power in what we had. And we're very tied into what we could do.
Are you still tapped in with some of those guys that you worked with when you were first getting started?
On the label side or the band side?
I mean, just in general, general, like on, like with the MCR, like street team and all the people that were on the message boards. And, you know, like, it sounds like to me, it was another avenue in music, especially in like this type of music, to make friendships across like the world.
Completely.
Yeah, are you like still tapped in with people you like never fucking met and like keep in contact with and shit?
A few people here and there. A few people kind of like find me, you know, on like Instagram now, or have found me throughout the years. You know, one of my closest friends, as I said, is my buddy Losi, who was, you know, the originator of the MCRmy. He came up with it with Mikey back in the day. So every time I'm in New York, I always go and hang with him. Every time he's in LA, I actually FaceTimed him the other day. We were talking about something. I was at a bar and I saw this guy look just like him and took a photo, and I was like, oh man, this is you if you lived in LA. And then, so we were FaceTiming that night, and, he had just got his hands on this, this demo, I think it was, or it wasn't a demo. It was like a, some sort of promo copy of Bullets. And I guess there's this crazy thing that happened where the 100 promo copies they made, 30 of them have the actual music and 70 of them have like a mariachi version recorded on it. So he got one of the 30. Yeah. So it's just a crazy thing. So he has hands on one of those. And so we were talking, and I was like, oh yeah, you know, I'm doing this podcast with Morgan and TJ. I was like, let's go buy CD. And he was telling me, he's like, oh yeah, you know, I lost, you know, a lot of stuff from back in the day. And I was like, oh yeah, let me see what I have. So I like went over to my little area that I have all my old CDs. And I was like, oh yeah, I got this one for FaceTime. He goes, man, now you're just showing off. And I have like a teenager single, Welcome to the Black Parade single. And then, you know, funnily enough, I know this is called, you know, CD burners. I'm like, oh man, I haven't even seen this for a long time. And this is like my old, like CD wallet. Yeah. And then I have the MCR sticker on the back, which is really funny. So I was going through there, and it had like some of my watermarks in it. And then I had like a burn CD, and it was like, this does not exist. And he's like, bro, play that. And I'm just like, I mean, it was probably like a record that was, you know, maybe leaked or something, you know? So it was really funny. And I couldn't get it to play. I'm like, what do I play this on? Like, maybe my PlayStation?
Yeah. Do you even have a CD drive? We've been talking about this. Like,
no, I need to order one on Amazon. It was like, just 2 nights ago. I was like, I'm going to order one on Amazon. He's like, please tell me what was on it. So
yeah,
to be determined, I will play it and send you guys a video.
Damn. I really would love to hear that mariachi version.
Yeah. But yeah, so still keep in touch with him. Alyssa Ayati is a really close friend of mine. You know, back in the day, she was known as Miss E. She was big on the MySpace scene, really big on music. She was at The Audience. Now she's the global head of social at Spotify. She's been a really close friend for many years. So there's a few core people. I mean, obviously, like Carl Ryan is a great friend, you know, music industry veteran, titan, great guy. So he was back with me at Warner in those days. So a few people, you know, here and there and then always just some like random people. I mean, now for the last 10 years of my career, I've worked in fashion, but it's interesting to meet a few people that are from those, early music days and early Warped Tour days specifically. You know, it's interesting to kind of catch them on the other side.
Damn, that's sick, dude. Like, I mean, are there any like specific moments, you know, that really stand out to you that, you know, ultimately like the point of this podcast is to give the people something that they shit that they just can't look up online, like things that aren't like in interviews, things that aren't like anywhere else. So if there are any like specific moments that stand out to you that you would be like, this was a great, you know, this was an essential part of this album. This was something that like I hold incredibly dear. This is an interesting fact that people should know. Like if you have any of those, like that's kind of like what we're trying to do. Dig around and find out some shit that you just can't fucking look up, you know?
Yeah, I mean, one of the interesting things was, you know, when the album was coming out, you know, we were going head to head with Miley and John Legend. And originally Brian was worried that John Legend was going to beat us out.
Oh, but it wasn't even Miley, was it? It was Hannah Montana.
Hannah Montana. Yes, yeah, so it was Hannah Montana. And like nobody even had thought that. We thought it was going to be us and John Legend. And I remember, you know, talking to Brian, and he's like, well, you know, this is what we're doing. And I was like, well, what are you thinking? Like, are we going to get number one? And he's like, oh, I'm worried about John Legend. And I was like, come on, we got this. And he's like, yeah, he has that little thing called a Grammy. And then out of nowhere, just Hannah Montana, not nowhere, but I mean, just, you know, pulverized us. So it was really cool seeing, you know, with the, Barbenheimer thing. There was a few of the memes that said this was the original Barbenheimer, and they showed the Hannah Montana versus the Black Parade that week.
Well, it's funny too, because both of those albums are like alter egos.
Yeah. So that was something really cool, and I remember, you know, we got the numbers when they had the show down at the House of Blues on Sunset, and I remember Brian telling me that we got number two. It was a really cool moment to look back on. But yeah, I mean, back in that day, you know, I remember the cool thing was, you know, seeing what they built through Three Cheers, and seeing how, you know, they built it and how close they were to the fans, how good they were to the fans, and seeing them continue to do that throughout. You know, they went all throughout Three Cheers. They did Warped Tour, Taste of Chaos, and then they went on, you know, their first headlining tour. I think I remember, you know, Gally saying something like, you know, their first headlining tour, they're doing arenas, which is wild. And, you know, they follow that up with, you know, the Black Parade. And then all throughout, they're still, you know, meeting so many fans. They're still, you know, staying true to themselves. You know, there was a lot of conversation, I remember, because, you know, it was us and Fall Out Boy. Through Three Cheers, and there's a lot of conversations of, hey, you know, should we take off the parental advisory on the record? And they're like, well, you know, they're like, Fall Out Boy's moving, and they're moving, and they're moving. Like, if we take off this, you know, we could probably sell another 15-25%. And I remember Brian really stuck to his guns and said, no, you know, this is a mature record meant for a mature audience. So, like, we're not going to sit here and try to peddle to a younger audience just to try to move it, which I thought was really cool and stuck in my mind.
Yeah, I like that's that. Something I like that, you know, I like when people stick to their shit. Like, I mean, I don't even think it like is a thing. Do they even have those anymore? I don't even fucking know.
I don't think so.
I think they just put like an E on like the next. Yeah, like haven't seen a fucking logo. Parental advisory.
I don't even know how they would gate it on Spotify either or anything like that. But yeah, that was. I mean, that was, you know, almost 18 years ago, but and that was something that I still remember, like, to this day, that was really cool. I remember him saying specifically in meeting.
Steve, do you remember a specific moment when you really saw the reception for this album, like, catching fire? Does anything sort of stick out to you as, like the moment when you were like, oh my God, like, this is going to be a massive thing? Because I know they released they performed the song on the MTV Video Music Awards. They performed that, and then they put it up on MySpace, I think, the next day. I don't know. Was there any like specific moment in the rollout campaign where you're like, it's happening, we're doing it?
It's tough because I knew it was going to be massive.
Yeah.
Because I knew there was something there. I knew there was something special. And you put so many pieces together. You just knew it was going to work. We had a dream team on board from, like I said, from Brian and Gerard's vision to, you know, everything that the people were doing in the merch department. And, you know, we had a recent departure at Warner with our marketing director that was there. So Xavier Ramos had left to go to another label, but we had both Jeff Watson stepping in, as well as partnered with Micho Dara, who's amazing. And, you know, between the two of them and everyone that was on radio and video, you know, you had Phil Costello and Denovan Sarno. Like, you just had a dream team of people across the board. You had Mark Webb. Like, it was just, you couldn't ask for a better team. And then you had the Welcome to the Black Parade video. You had, you know, like I said, Mark Webb followed up with, you know, I Don't Love You. I can't even pinpoint a moment because it was just like hit after, like it was just, it was domino after domino falling into place. I think when I heard Famous Last Words, the song, mm-hmm. I was like, yeah, like it's going to happen. I think that was the point for me. When I really knew like, okay, this is gonna, there's no way this is not going to be bigger than the last record.
Totally. Nice. Well, great. I don't know if I really have anything else. Do you, Morgan?
I mean, not really. I just like, you know, it's, I think what is interesting to me is to really get the, to really try and like put into words what the feeling was when these things came out, and trying to like capture, yeah, try to capture the vibe of like what the atmosphere of the scene was like, you know, because it is so bad, it's like so fucking different now.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, especially with some of the albums that we've been reviewing, it's like, you know, really we're like, oh, what was it like in this time, like what was, you know, and that, and so I don't know. The only other real thing I would want to know is, you know, like what was it like? What was the for you? What was it like in the scene at that time? Like what do you like? What do you look back super fondly on? And what do you like really? You know, what do you miss that like doesn't happen today?
Yeah, I would say the thing that I miss is just like how they brought together so many different groups of people. I know that's like a oddly, you know, generic or an oddly cliche thing to say, but I think it was truly the case with them. Like I remember seeing them open for Face to Face at the House of Blues Sunset at a show, and like these dudes were all about it. And I think it was truly that truly was the case where like you'd see dudes in their, you know, mid late 30s that loved My Chem and were just singing along to every song. And then you saw girls that were, you know, in their teens that were up there against the barricade singing along and had camped out every night. So I think that it was cool because there was something there for everyone. And it just brought so many people together and you could tell that they had a real connection with the band. So I would say that's the thing that I do miss the most. And I think that, you know, it was that combination of, you know, everybody is welcome. And I think Gerard did such a great job, you know, as the front man of, you know, setting that tone and setting the expectation that like, this is a safe place. And before it was, you know, kind of the, you know, let's say like trendy or cool thing to do or the thing that you had to say. Like I remember him saying that very early on Warped Tour when there was not as many people, you know, there, you know, saying like, hey girls, like there's going to be a guy here that's going to try to give you a pass, you know, and tell you to show him your boobs or something to get a backstage pass. So if you see him, tell him, fuck you, you know, like, you know, it's really cool. I remember that when they were first, you know, before they were headlining Warped Tour, him saying that. So I think that was the thing I missed the most is that like he genuinely brought so many people together. And it was a cool space that just everyone was welcome. Everyone was, you know, there, and there wasn't this, you know, even like BS around, hey, you know, this is just like my secret band that, mm-hmm. you know, I don't want to tell everybody about. It was something that like everybody was welcome. If you had just heard about the band yesterday or you found that, or you heard about them because a pop station started playing, you know, a certain song, like you were welcome and, you know, happy to join in.
Well, I think that's like a real testament because like that was before all this like bullshit, people just saying shit on social media to be like, all right, what do we have to fit in right now? What do we have to fit in with like what the companies want to see? What do we have to say and fit in to like make sure that we get a bag? It's, you know, that saying all of this before, saying all of that stuff and actually forming a real community before it was like, you know, a social norm to do so says a lot about a band, and you know it's very, very cool to know that some of that shit, he wasn't saying it because it was going to be fucking filmed and put on something. It was saying it because it was like actually how they felt. So that I think that is a, to me, you know, it might seem really insignificant, but I think that is a really important piece to this band and this album.
Completely.
That's all I got.
Steve, thank you so much for hopping on with us. We really appreciate your insight, and thanks for sharing those stories with us. If you find any pictures of the MCR Black Parade van, would love to see that. But otherwise, man, thank you so much. Very insightful. We appreciate you being here.
Cool. Thanks again for having me.
Thanks, dude. It was really good to see you and talk to you, man. Appreciate it.
Likewise. Have a good one.
All right, brother. Yeah, so we were talking about you like a week prior, because we, you know, I was telling you about this podcast we're doing, and we're, you know, it's not like reviews of albums, but it's like a deep dive into them. And so your name has been coming up, you know, quite a bit. And so it's just,
oh, thanks.
It's just like by chance, I got to come and say hey and be like, hey, you want to do this? So everybody, you know, meet Rob Cavallo. Is
all right.
Incredible and legendary producer.
We actually wanted to jump in and ask some questions specifically about the Black Parade, because that's the album that we're diving into. We're kind of going through all of the albums that are being played at When We Were Young Fest this year. So obviously the big headline moment this year will be the Black Parade.
So
nice.
Yeah. So we, you know, and this was like, you know, we do a decent amount of research on like all these albums, but you know, what I think is really interesting is to find out and talk to not the band, but the people that were around and actually in the studio and making the albums and their friends and things that, you know, you can't just look up in an interview, right? I think that to me is what I find the most interesting about any sort of project, is like, what can't I look up? What do you have to like, we'd have to like really dive deep into this. So, you know, you know, I'd love for you to like stay on just a couple seconds afterwards, but you know, just to make sure we're good with your time. Like let's pop right into it.
Let's go.
T, do you want to, you know what, I'll ask my first question, because this is something that like at the time, you know, when I was listening to some interviews around when the album was made, I guess it was the most tracks ever used in a Pro Tools session at the time. I don't
know. Is that true?
Yeah, is that true?
Well, I can't really speak to the hundreds or thousands of other tracks, you know, that had made, but maybe possibly for at that time an alternative rock project, it might have been the most tracks, because you see, there's a whole story. I could tell you a whole story about it.
Please.
The idea of the Black Parade was actually certainly what the record was about, but it wasn't actually supposed to be on that song. It was supposed to be a different song. It was supposed to be its own song. It was, you know, when you hear a parade from very far away, it's very quiet, right? And then as it gets closer, it gets louder and louder and louder. And then you see all the spectacle and everything. And then it passes you by and it gets quiet again as it goes away. So Gerard had this idea. And strangely, one morning I got to the studio early and so did he. And I got there like maybe 5 minutes before him, but there was nobody else around. And I was just practicing piano. Can you give me like, you know, the graduation waltz, the graduation, you know, the da 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 da. He's like, okay, so I want something with that kind of pomp and circumstance, right? That kind of thing, but I want it to go down, just continually going down, right? So I did one of those things where I was like, oh, don't think, just play, you know, and literally popping out of my fingers was ding 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 ding. And then he was like, that's perfect. Okay. And then he just was, when I was a young boy, my father. And then we fucked around with that for like 15 minutes. And then we recorded it on a voicemail thing. And we were like, fuck yeah, we got something, right? And that was going to be that Black Parade, you know, interstitial moment on the record. And then when everybody got there, we cut it. And I played my piano bit and I started real high and, you know, like the way you hear it on the record. And then I started going down until I was playing it like grand Beethoven, giant, big chords, everything, and then worked my way back up to quiet and tiny.
because that was the way that, you know, we thought it was going to be. And then there was this idea. I know you started this question, like, why so many tracks? Well, the idea was, is that we were going to have a marching band and everything else that you could have on the song, right? Because that was the idea. It was a parade that was of, you know, the glockenspiel and the kick drums, you know, the big giant booming drums and the all the stuff that goes along with the marching band. So then we also had this other song called Carry On, right? And Carry On didn't really have an intro, and it even had different chords. It was like a little bit different. So what happened was, is this is the craziest thing. I actually, like a week later, I had to leave on a Wednesday because I had like a quick family weekend. I had to do something with the family. And when I got back on Monday, they were like, I got back and the guys and the engineer, Doug McKean, was like, they're like, you're not going to believe what we did. I was like, what? And they took the first half of what was the Black Parade, and they stuck it onto what was the Carry On song, right? And then, so I was like, oh my God, that's amazing. Like, I can't believe this song really works now. It's like, it's unbelievable. And then we were like, well, what are we gonna do? Like, and we were like, you know, like, how do we have the marching band and the parade and the whole thing? And we were immediately like, let's put it on the Carry On song too. Like, if we're gonna have it on the front, let's keep it, let's like throw the kitchen sink at it, which is what we kind of said. So we ended up putting strings and horns and orchestral percussion and hammer bells, glockenspiel, whatever else you could think of. I mean, like, I actually, there was something like 257 tracks.
Yeah, that's a wild. So, we read that you played keys on the album. Are you the guy that actually pressed that iconic G note?
Yes, I am. I am the guy that did that. It was a funny thing too, because I am like, I'm a reluctant musician in the studio, but if I'm the right guy to do it, I will do it. And I usually have to calm myself down and like smoke a cigarette or two to be like, you know, cooler than I am, I guess, to be able to play it. And I'm always telling the trick of the idea that, you know, if you want to tell the kids out there like how to play that song, because there's sort of a weird ghosty sort of feeling to that. The reason why everyone can sort of tell, like everyone tells me, oh, you know, I recognize that G note, you know. The reason why is if you, there's a damper pedal on the piano, and it's the pedal on the floor that's like most to the right. And the trick is just before you hit that G note, like stomp on it. I mean, and then what happens is all the dampers on all the strings kind of come up, and this air sound comes out of the piano because all the strings are slightly vibrating because the dampers have been pulled off the string.
Wow.
And now they're very sympathetic to any note you hit. And so when I just crunched that G note, I went ding, and every other G note and every other D note would vibrate sympathetically along with that first note. And that's why it has that flavor that sounds like there's a ghost in it or something, you know.
Dude,
it's a trick, really.
Honestly, like one of the most, look, we've been doing this for a while, like probably one of the, this is, you know, at least to, you know, me, that was probably like one of the coolest stories that we could hear, like how that got made is like, this is why we're doing this, by the way. I think you pretty much encapsulated like exactly why we're doing this. So
now selfishly, I have to ask you,
you guys are the first ones to hear it.
That's awesome.
I think you guys are the first ones to hear it. I think, I don't know if I've ever told that, but, or if Gerard has, I don't know, maybe.
I have to ask you selfishly, since you were just at Emo Night this past weekend, how it felt to hear a record that you created getting played 10 years after the fact without the band even being there and seeing people still resonating with this song. Like, did you ever expect somebody would be DJing the Black Parade in a nightclub when you were recording it?
No. Well, yes and no. The answer is yes, and how did it feel? There's a triple answer to that. Wait, can you guys hold on 1 second really quick?
Yeah, of course.
You guys, hold on 1 second. I'm just going to mute.
I like Rob.
Okay, guys, I'm back.
Okay, sweet.
Hello? You can hear me. All right, so here's the crazy thing. So it's like, and I think, Morgan, I told you this when I met you. It was like, I went to one of the first emo nights, and yeah. I thought, this is amazing. Yeah, I was there because I was like, what are they going to play at emo? Because a lot of people, like, call me, like, I don't know. I mean, I don't like saying it this way personally, but, like, you know, like, an originator of emo or a king of emo because of all the, I mean, arguably I did some of the biggest emo records or influential emo records, I guess. You know, just having done Dear You and Black Parade kind of is enough in a way to give me some emo cred, I guess. And then, so I went to one of those early nights and I thought, and I watched the kids and they were just so into it, you know, and I saw the passion of the young kids, and this was like 10 years ago, maybe 9 years ago. I don't know. It's a long time ago when I went to the first emo night, you know, and certainly the Avalon was not done up like the way it is now, but it was really awesome. And I watched how, you know, what these songs meant to kids. And I watched it online and I watched it just growing and growing and growing. It was, to me, I always felt like when Black Parade first came out, it did very well. And definitely very happy with it, but I actually felt like this record is broader and bigger than people realize at the time. Like, that was my feeling about the record. So the fact that generations of kids have now picked up, because that record is 20 years ago or 19 yeah. 18 years ago, and so in one way I'm not surprised because I saw the signs. However, being there that night and watching you play, because you personally played teenagers, and I watched the crowd go absolutely bonkers. I mean, one of the two high points of the night was playing teenagers in Black Parade.
Yeah, for sure. Always.
Probably every emo night, right? Mm-hmm. And I watched them screaming every single lyric, you know, and I watched them, you know, making a mosh pit, and the it's almost an experience. The feeling that I get from it is absolute, total, and complete, utter joy and happiness.
Love that.
It's very satisfying, you guys, because to see these young kids, like, almost like dancing their demons away,
yeah,
and yelling, means something to them. And there's also like a community spirit that arises, and so that, like, I was a part of, you know, being there and doing that. I mean, another, you know, sort of untold story about the Black Parade is actually the song Teenagers itself, because without naming any names, there were some people that did not want Teenagers on the record, and me and Mikey lost our minds. We were like, and I'm not talking band members, but, you know, Gerard wrote the song and he kind of was like, and this can happen a lot, he, you know, you could ask him, but it was sort of like, he was like, oh yeah, that's kind of a funny song I wrote. And I was like, well, what did it mean to you? And he's like, well, it was a funny song, but it was actually, I was serious. I was actually scared of teenagers because of Columbine and because of the things that were sort of happening at that time with, you know, what you got under your shirt will make them pay for the things that they did. I mean, you know, he's talking about the horror of bringing guns to school, you know, that on one level is like really heavy. But it was also, he was doing it sort of tongue in cheek, right? And he was also having a serious message, but it was also, you know, a song that some people, like, who were in the more executive side, like, thought, sure, maybe that's just a jokey song, and maybe that's a 1-4-5, like an old school rock song. One of the quotes was, I don't want any old school rock songs on this new fangled rock record. And my thing was like, well, do you know how hard it is to write a great 1-4-5 song, meaning like E, A, and B, or actually, mm-hmm, in this case, it's B, B, E, and F sharp. It's like, it's the hardest thing to do. And I was like arguing, I was saying, no, this guy's actually like, it takes a genius to write a song that all the kids are going to relate to and have it be great, that it's the 1-4-5 song, meaning that it's just straight rock and roll chords, and to have it be that meaningful. So I think he's actually hitting it out of the fucking park, and I'm going to throw myself in front of a fucking train if we don't get this song on the record.
Good. I mean, look, dude, that's the way that we, it's in the creative field. It's really like, I found it's really, really difficult to talk to, you know, people up that make the, they don't do this. They don't do what we do. They don't do like a creative process. They're just like, they look at the things that like for face value and they go, how is this going to sell? And then like the people that actually make this and have a relationship to it really can visualize how far it goes and how big it actually is. So I'm really happy that you guys really fought for that. I mean, this is a two-parter, but is this the first like concept album that you worked on? And if, you know, if so, like, not really even if so, but.
Well, American Idiot had come out 2 years prior. So it definitely wasn't the first one. And you did Rent as well. Shit. Which all is, right, never is mind. A similar thing. But I guess like how does this as a concept album compare to something like American Idiot? And how does it compare to like making a regular straightforward collection of 12 songs?
You know, it's a funny thing. I actually really like making records that are tied together thematically. You know, the discipline of it came for me out of having done a lot of movies. Because the very first soundtrack I ever did was the little movie called Angus, which wasn't a hit.
Oh, but, dude, I know if you can Angus. Imagine... yeah.
That's cool. You know Angus. Angus was like a little love of mine because I read this script and I was like, this is great. You know, you got to remember this is going back to like 1995. And so the idea that there's a young boy who's in high school who's overweight and has two mothers, you know, he's got gay parents, you know, and the fact that he's teased and there's things going on in his life. I was like, this is like the perfect like punk rock sort of thing. And so I started fitting. I discovered I really liked the challenge of fitting songs into movies. And then the very next movie I did was City of Angels, where we had I did the Google song Iris and Dennis Morissette's song Uninvited. I really liked those songs were tailor made for those movies.
Oh, okay.
And then I liked working with directors and putting the discipline of putting songs into a story. You know, I ended up doing Rent with Andrew Lloyd Webber. I'm sorry, Rent. I just take that back. I ended up doing School of Rock live on Broadway with Andrew Lloyd Webber. And I got to arrange all those songs and talk with him about like what songs should he write and how should we get them to fulfill the emotion of a character or a certain scene. So to me, that was like really fun. So the idea then of doing these kinds of sort of, I don't know what the right word is, but sort of multitasking, multi-dimensional concept albums was like really fun. It's like, oh, what's going to happen here? Right. It changes. It's not just a collection of songs. It's like, what are we going to put here? It actually, or how are we going to tell this story here? Right. And so then working with the artist and then crafting the songs and the arrangements to get them to mean something more to me actually made making records even more interesting. Cause I thought like there was then more meat on the bone for a listener to fall into. So I was so into it. Yeah.
Does it get more challenging though? Because, you know, cause it does flow so well, right? Like it does flow so well. Are there parts that you got like stuck and you're like, I don't know how to move this part to this part. Like, I don't know which song goes into this song, like how we do that. Like, cause I like as a whole, you want it to be a complete project, especially for something like this. Are there any points that you got like really hung up on where you like didn't know how to fix it and how you guys did to fix it?
Yes. I will tell you that it is more taxing and it is part of a challenge, but I actually am one of those people that like give me the challenge and then I love to rise up to it. If it's sort of boring, then I'll be like, I could be potentially sort of bland about it also. Like, so I like being on the hot seat. And so, because the reward is so much, like you say, oh man, how do we get to this next section? Or how do we do this? Then sometimes it would be weeks where nothing would come, you know? And we went up to this place. It's pretty well documented. With Black Radio, we went up to that house called Paramore, which is totally haunted and crazy. And I think there's pictures of it in the big deluxe set thing you can look at. And you could hear the demos. We made these. We just put two mics up and we recorded the band live. And we got probably about 80% of the record there. We didn't get Black Parade. Back then, it was still just Carry On with different chords. It didn't sound like a hit. You can actually hear it. But when you're sitting there scratching your head and beating your head against the desk to like come up with the answer, I would say that there's sort of a, I don't know what the right word is. I want to say something cheesy, like there's a divinity in the idea that if you can have patience and the artist is in it and you're in it with them and you know you're waiting for your best work to come out, that and then when you recognize that answer, it is so satisfying to then put that down on tape, you know, or in the Pro Tools in the computer, right? It's definitely an exercise in patience and in hard work, but like I absolutely love it because I call it like, are we in the hunt? In the hunt. I'm in the hunt. And that just means when we're in the studio and we're making stuff, we're hunting for the good. We're hunting for the inspired. And then when we're capturing it, you know, we're in the hunt, and that's fucking great. It's so fun.
I think like what's really strange is that like some of the best, you can't time creative. Like you can't be like, all right, at this day we're going to do this and this is going to sound like this is. Like I like that you did touch on patience, because something that, you know, we've been talking about as a company, it's like trying to fit a square peg into a round hole to make something work. And sometimes it is just time. And that's something that like you can't explain to anybody who hasn't like gone through that process. So I'm actually really, I'm kind of surprised that that was the answer that you got, but that was that's the answer that like I was looking for as a guy who makes stuff, because I'm, you know, it's really difficult to be like, all right, scheduling a day to do this thing that is we're thinking of, you know, as it's just time to make it like perfect. It is. I'm really happy that that's the answer you gave, man. That makes me feel personally a lot better. Were there any, I know this, our audience, you know, very, very spooky people. Like, you know, I think that they're going to be very, there are some documented stories about like what happened in the Paramore house, but in regards to the record, but did you experience anything interesting? You know,
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. I mean, there was a couple of times, I mean, there's like coats of arms and there's like a giant polar bear statue. That's like, you know, I mean, a stuffed polar bear. And there was this downstore, there was this underneath, there was like two kitchens because it used to house a lot of people, like nuns or something. It was crazy. And every once in a while you would just hear downstairs a door just slam shut like out of nowhere, and you'd be like, well, who's down there? And the answer is like, there's nobody down there. Like, why did that happen, right? And then Mikey, like, you know, he was, that house got to him. I mean, he, you know, it's documented, but it's like, he was like, I can't stay here anymore. This is crazy. But maybe the funnest story for me anyways, personally, was I was born March 21st, right? And there's a place that I like to go to. It's called the Red Lion Inn. It's very German. It's in Los Feliz, whatever.
Yeah.
Silver Lake, yeah. And it's really close there. And it was my birthday. I don't know what year it was. I might have been, I don't know, I was maybe 40 or something. And so my wife and I, we got a step van, and we put in like probably like 10 couples. So, and they're all like non-music business people. They're just like regular, you know, friends of my wife, like regular people, right? And I say, all right, this is what we're going to do. We're going to go to the Red Lion Inn. But before you go to the Red Lion Inn, I'm going to give you a tour of the Paramore house, right? And I said to everybody, it's haunted. And they're like, yeah, it's fucking haunted, whatever. And so we get there and we drive up that creepy fucking driveway. We go through that crazy big fucking front door. We go past the polar bear. We go past the coat of arms. We go past all the weird ass pictures, the chandelier. We go into the great room, which has got like 30-foot high ceilings. And if the chandelier was to fall off the ceiling, it would kill like 40 people, you know, that kind of a thing. And then I said, I want to take you guys upstairs, this creaky little stairs, to where the bedrooms are, right? And that's where, like, everyone said it was the most haunted. And I couldn't turn the fucking lights on. And we're walking down this hallway, and we're looking into these darks, and it was, swear to God, it was just like a fucking horror movie. And then all of a sudden, one of those doors slammed or something happened, and every girl that was walking around started fucking screaming their heads off. I mean, I'm talking like real. Whatever it was, it set them off. It was like, I saw something. You know, they're screaming. It was so fucking funny. And they turned around running at me and ran down the stairs and went right back onto the step band and said, take us to the restaurant. We're out of here.
Dude, did they think you had that planned? Did they think you had that planned out? They're like, oh, you fucked with us.
They totally thought I had it planned. And the real truth is I did not have it planned. There was nothing planned. It just was that fucking creepy up there. It was creepy. This is great. I mean, we laugh about it to this day, and it's funny because if that group of couples comes around and I mention it, the girls are like, "Fuck you, Rob."
Well, Rob, we don't want to take up too much of your time. We really appreciate you hopping on with us. I know that everybody's going to appreciate this interview a lot. It was super interesting, and thank you so much for sharing so much with us. This was really awesome.
Dude, I can't wait to have you on again for another album, man. This is really, really fun. I think this is one of my favorite interviews that we've done. So I really do appreciate that.
It's a pleasure. Anytime.